Inside Science.
This is a cell culture of SARS-CoV-19, the coronavirus responsible for the COVID-19 pandemic, and the reason why I'm currently recording this in my living room. This month, we learnt a lot about it. For a start, the virus can survive up to 3 days on plastic and stainless steel surfaces, and at least 3 hours in microscopic droplets in the air. That's according to research from the National Institute of Health. Although during that time, the amount of viable virus decreases rapidly. A new work from Johns Hopkins suggests that anyone unlucky enough to be infected will begin to see symptoms after, on average, just over 5 days. But the researchers also predict that around 1 in 100 people could go over 2 weeks before showing symptoms. And that's a problem, because people can still be infectious during that time, even though they don't feel sick. And this can lead to undocumented spread of the disease. In China, before the travel lockdown, undocumented spread like this could have been responsible for up to 86% of new infections, according to another new study. The mathematicians that modelled this also found that when the Chinese government put in movement restrictions, it substantially reduced the spread of undocumented infections, as well as the spread of the disease as a whole. And that's a good thing, because COVID-19 is deadly. But actually calculating just how deadly is quite difficult. But to work out what proportion of people die from the disease, first you need to know exactly how many people have had it in the first place. But many people never develop serious symptoms, so the true number of sufferers is underreported. Step forward, researchers from the University of Hong Kong. They modelled what the real case numbers could be, based on the number of travellers from Wuhan Airport that tested positive after arriving at their destination, as well as the initial growth rate of the epidemic. From this, they estimate that, as of the end of February, the chance of dying after contracting COVID-19 was 1.4%. But within that, there is a marked age difference. On average, the over 60s are around 5 times more at risk than those between 30 and 59. Now, of course, doctors and medical workers are trying to keep that percentage down, but that brings us to another evolving issue with COVID-19. In some places, there are simply too many patients for each one to receive adequate care. This has had devastating consequences in Italy, and New York City might be next. There's not enough space, or beds, or healthcare workers, or ventilators to go around, so physicians may have to choose who gets treated and who doesn't. And with supplies low, some hospital workers are resorting to altering existing equipment to make more respirators, like taking scuba masks and adapting tubing to use one ventilator for more than one person. And you can read more about this story here on the Inside Science webpage. But if you want to find out which of your friends might have caught it, a good place to look might be Facebook. And that's because people changed the style of their Facebook language in the days leading up to a hospital emergency department visit. An algorithm trained to analyse people's Facebook vocabulary found less swearing, less informal language like lol and your, and more words associated with family like baby and ma, as well as more anxious language. And knowing these trends, the algorithm could, more often than not, predict the times when Facebook users would go to the hospital. And the researchers who ran the study hoped that this kind of data mining of social media could help health workers predict potentially at-risk patients before they even chose to come in. And lastly, let's take a step back from pandemics and predictions and take a trip into the quantum realm. The subatomic particles that live down here have a property called spin. And we can use this spin to our advantage. For example, to tell us about the environment that a particle is in, like with magnetic resonance imaging, or to store information, as in quantum computing. But up until now, to manipulate spin, we've had to use powerful magnetic fields. And that is, until a team of physicists trying to do just this, mistakenly blew up their own magnet. And in doing so, transformed this area of quantum science. They published the result of their magnetic mishap this month. They mistakenly created a powerful electric field, which could change a particle's spin itself. Now, this kind of electric control of spin had been suggested before, back in the 60s, but never shown. This experiment at last shows how it can be done, and this new tool can control a particle's spin much more precisely than large, hard-to-control magnetic fields. All this could potentially pave the way for more sensitive detectors and even new kinds of quantum computers. And that's it from me this month. Stay safe. Goodbye.
Inside Science. If you enjoyed this edition, follow us on the web and social media. Powered by the American Institute of Physics and a coalition of underwriters.